All right. Good morning, everybody. My name is David, and it's my privilege to be able to lead the service here this morning. And as we meet together, we encourage each other in the Word of God that will be brought to us by Stephen from Romans chapter 3. We encourage each other as we have fellowship together, and we encourage each other as we sing really words and songs that really build us up as Christians. And we thank you, Lord, for the gifts that you've given to people who exercise all these different aspects of our service this morning. Now, as we come to the service this morning, just to prepare our thoughts for what we're going to be doing. This morning, as Steve talks from Romans, we're going to be talking about that faith alone is the key to a salvation. And we remember the words of Ephesians that we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, that God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So we see that faith leads to action, and we live in a world in which there's constant difficulty and conflict, but the battle that we see is God's battle, and we are his servants, and those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ go out each day as witnesses to him. So we're going to stand now, and we're going to sing our first song, The Ancient of Days. Please stand.
See what the future brings. Well, this song is a great song. It's a great song for the kids because it reminds them that God can talk to them. They can talk to God at any time. They can pray at any time. Even though God is the Ancient of Days, He's big and powerful, He loves us enough to want to talk to us. And so that this song reminds us that we can do that. But it's also not just for the kids to remember this. It's actually something for all of us to remember, that God, we can talk to God any time, even when you're out kicking a ball. I know that's many of you are doing that all the time. So
I want to see lots of good dance moves, both kids and adults. Let's get into this. Jesse, lead the way.
Okay. One, two, three, four.
You can't tell the Lord that you love Him anytime. You can't tell the Lord that you need Him anytime. Thank Him for His love and care. Shoot Him up an arrow. You can't tell the Lord that you love Him. In the middle of whatever you're doing at school, at lunch when you're kicking the ball, when you're chasing your mates all over the place, you can talk to the Lord of all. You can tell the Lord that you love Him anytime. You can tell the Lord that you need Him anytime. Thank Him for His love and care. Shoot Him up an arrow, prayer. You can tell the Lord that you love Him anytime. When you're happy as a lamb, you're full of joy. When you're blown up by the view, give thanks to the God who showered His blessings. Shine His blessings on you and you and you. The Lord that you love Him anytime. You can tell the Lord that you need Him anytime. Thank Him for His love and care. Shoot Him up an arrow. You can tell the Lord that you love Him. You can tell the Lord that you need Him. You can tell the Lord that you love Him anytime.
All right, please take a seat. Now, as you all know, all over the world, people have been gathering in one spot to celebrate a very important event. I'm not talking about the coronation, I'm talking about Jesse's birthday! Yay! It's Jesse's birthday today. How old are you today, my friend? How old are you today? Three? Wow, that's very Trinitarian of you. Now, we've got one more song to sing, don't we? What song could that be, Jess?
Okay.
Wasn't quite as loud as the three cheers at the coronation last night, but it was still pretty awesome. Great to have you with us today, Jesse, on your birthday. Okay, now I'm going to need one special volunteer called Emily. There we go. Okay, now I have a challenge for Emily. Might do this challenge up on the stage, actually. So walk up onto the stage, Emily, so everyone can see. Okay. Now. Okay, so I'll stand at this one. All right, now in this box here, I have some Duplo. And I am also going to set a timer.
a 1 minute timer, and Amelie has to build a wall. Okay, so I'll set my timer. And then, hang on, I'll let you tell you. So you won't need the cars and other things. They're just there to distract you. All right, now, are you ready, Amelie, to build your wall? No, I'm. Are you ready, Amelie? Are you sure you're ready?
No.
Go. This is the wall that you've managed to create in 1 minute. And was it an easy thing to do?
No, not particularly. You didn't
know. What made it difficult?
Well, you were throwing the jack at me and poking me. It's generally in pain.
Yeah, so it's really hard to build a wall when other people are trying to stop you from building that wall. Hmm. Well, we're going to be talking about that today out at Kids at Church and Little Kids at Church. Because we're doing the story of Nehemiah. Because God's people managed to come all the way back to Jerusalem. That's where we're up to as we work our way through the Bible. They managed to come all the way back to Jerusalem. But when they tried to build the walls, there were some people trying to stop them. And we're going to see what happened when Nehemiah turned up to help the people build the wall. So it wasn't quite as fun to watch, I'm sure, as me poking Amelie and throwing my jacket on her and everything. But I'm also sure that their wall looked a little bit more impressive than that one. Although I think that does deserve a clap. Yeah, yes. Well done, Amelie.
Okay, and your reward, Amelie. You get to carry the Duplo box up the back of church. Okay.
So great, wasn't it? Now we're moving on to the more formal part of our service, but it's still a really good time that we have as we say and we think through various things together. The world we live in is a world of conflict, but the spiritual battle that we fight is really God's battle, and we are His soldiers, we are His servants, but we're in a sense that we are imperfect, and that sometimes that we fail in various ways in our lives. And we're going to say now together the General Confession. And after we've done that, we're immediately going to say the Apostles' Creed, because the Apostles' Creed state the things that we believe in as Christians, that we uphold. So we say together now, Most merciful God, we humbly admit that we need your help. We confess that we have wandered from your way. We have done wrong. We have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us. Wipe out our sins and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of the Spirit, that we may live as disciples of Christ. This we ask in the name of Jesus our Saviour. Amen. And now the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Well, we're going to have now our two Bible readings, and immediately after that, Steve will be bringing God's word to us this morning.
So, Romans chapter 3, starting at verse 21. But now a righteousness from God, apart from the law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. On what principle? On that of observing the law? No, but on that of faith. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. Is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of the Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too, since there is only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith. Do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law.
Ephesians chapter 2, the first 10 verses. Paul writing, of course, to his friends in Ephesians, in Ephesus, about the state that we've been in before and after Christ has come into our lives. Paul writes, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you all. If you'd like to open your Bibles to Romans chapter 3, in a moment we'll turn there. But before we do, let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the opportunity to meet together like this. We thank you for your word. We thank you that in it you reveal our heart, what our heart is like, but also what our hope is. And so today, as we look at this beautiful passage of Scripture, I pray that you would speak to our hearts, that you would encourage us, that you would strengthen us, that you would fill us with joy. Help me to not get in the way of what you want to say to us, Lord, but instead to point us to how we should respond to your word, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, just over a week ago was Anzac Day, And on Anzac Day, we look back and remember the first kind of military campaign that we as a nation, as a new federation of states, undertook. And one of our first battles that we entered was, of course, the battle to capture the Gallipoli Peninsula in April 1915. Unfortunately, bad currents and even worse planning meant that they landed in the wrong spot. They landed at a place that was heavily fortified and was terribly difficult terrain. The ensuing battle dragged on for some 8 months with huge numbers of casualties on both sides. In the end, the battle was an abject defeat. And on that day, April 25th, has become etched in our psyche, hasn't it, as a nation. It says something important about what it means to be Australian. As we celebrate people giving the ultimate sacrifice, 8,000 plus who died and many more who came back wearing the physical and emotional scars of war. Since that day, as a nation, we've celebrated, haven't we? We've looked back and we've remembered. We're very proud of that day. It's a very profound day for Australians, I think. But that idea of the people giving the ultimate sacrifice is one that actually speaks to this passage that we're looking at today, Romans chapter 3. This passage was described by one of the commentators as the greatest paragraph that has ever been written, which is pretty high praise, right? So let's look at this paragraph. You may not have quite picked that up as it was going through, but it certainly is. So let's turn to Romans chapter 3. And before we actually get to the passage we're on, we need to remember where we've just been. Last week was a bit of a depressing sermon. I don't know if you know that. I was giving it. I was depressed. It was pretty bleak. There were certainly no rose-coloured glasses. We were looking from chapter 1, verse 18, all the way to chapter 3, verse 20. And in the end, we saw how terrible people are. It really was summed up pretty direly in those verses from chapter 3, verse 10, where Paul writes, "There is no one who is righteous, not even one. No one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. All they have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one." Look at the person next to you. They're listening to the other side, people in front of you and behind you. They are lousy. They are wicked. They are sinful. Now look in the mirror, and that's you too. All of us. All of us are worthless. All of us are sinful because we have turned away from God. It's a pretty dire picture, isn't it? And it's not just that we're bad and we should scold ourselves, but actually, because of that, we're told in chapter 1, verse 1, that we are now objects of God's wrath. God is angry with you and with me because of our sin, because of our godlessness and wickedness. Every one of us. It's like we've dug this great gulf between us and God. If you ever go to Sydney, you may have seen the Sydney Harbour. And if you go to the north side of Sydney Harbour, you're in Milsons Point. And if you look over the harbour, one of the things you see is the Opera House. I don't know if you've ever tried jumping from Milsons Point to the Opera House. It's rather difficult. In fact, it's impossible. It doesn't matter who you are, whether you're 90 or 19, whether you are an Olympic long jump record holder or somebody who falls over their own feet, it doesn't matter who you are. If you try to jump from Milsons Point to the Opera House, you will never get there. Everyone will end up wet. And that's what it's like for us trying to get to God. Because of our sinfulness, we can never get there. We can never get back to Him. We were created for this awesome, intimate relationship with God, but we've mucked it up. We've ruined it. And so now we are lost. Not even the law that God gave to His people can help. So the very last verse we looked at last week, chapter 3, verse 20, "Therefore no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. All the law does is help us become conscious of sin. It just shows us how bad we are, how lost we are." And so last week, as I said, was a little bit depressing because we were left with that picture of, oh man, we've got no chance. We were created to be with God and now we've ruined it and there's nothing we can do to get ourselves back. As I say, it was a pretty depressing sermon. However, today's passage starts with one of the most beautiful words in the Bible. You may not think it's a very beautiful word, but it really is. It's the word but. But. Yes, that may all be the case, but now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God or righteousness from God has been made known. God is going to show us his righteousness and how we can become righteous, how we can get back to where we were supposed to be. At the moment, we're all lost. Paul actually reminds us about that in chapter 3, verse 23, that famous verse, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All of us tried jumping towards God, but we've all ended up in the drink. We cannot get there. No one can be righteous. No one is righteous. So how is it that God is going to make us acceptable to him again? How is God going to make us righteous? To bring us back to that relationship with him. That's what it means to be righteous, to have this unsullied, unbroken relationship with God. How can we get there? Well, you know the answer, don't you? The answer is? Jesus, of course. The answer is Jesus. And it's true. Often it's, you know, you've heard that story about the Sunday school teacher describing, I want you to tell me, kids, what this is. It's kind of grey and it's got... it's furry and it's got a little black nose and it's little fuzzy ears and it lives in Australia on gum trees and eats only eucalypts, and all the kids are waiting, they're trying to answer. They don't want to answer because they're a bit scared. And so he asks one of the children, who is it? What is it? And he says, well, I know the answer's Jesus, but it sounds like a koala, right? So the answer here actually is Jesus. Jesus is the answer. So what is it that Jesus has done? And so we're going to go back over some very familiar territory about what Jesus has done. It's really important for us to continue to preach this gospel to ourselves, to remind ourselves of what we have. So from verse 24, we get a whole litany of religious words, like litany, okay? We get a whole list of religious words. And so as we go through, we're going to try and understand. Bruce Parker, who did this reading in the morning, said this reading is actually just like one sentence, but actually it's this idea that she's growing and growing and growing and becoming more and more amazing. So let's read it. Verse 23, we're reminded, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace. All are justified. That word justified basically means acquitted, declared not guilty. Even though we are guilty, we're declared not guilty. As I was speaking to Loris earlier, she reminded me that the word justified, if you want to remember what it means, it's just as if I'd never sinned. Okay, so we become righteous. So God is going to justify us to make us right. How is he going to do that? Well, he can't just sweep it all under the carpet. Imagine if there was a judge who just said, look, all these murderers and, you know, sexual predators and all these things come before him, and the judge says, look, you've done these things, but I'll just let you off. It's okay. Don't worry. How do you feel that the media and our society will react to that? Pretty badly, wouldn't it? Be terrible. He'd be looking for another job pretty quickly. But so God, if that's true of a human judge, he can't just go let people off the things that they've done wrong. How much more is it that God can't do that? Because God is just and fair and holy. How could God possibly just justify us like that? He can't just sweep it all under a carpet. So what's he going to do? Well, how does he do it? Well, he does it through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. Another great religious word, being redeemed. But what does it mean? Does anyone know what the word redemption means? Being bought back. Okay, so it's like if you're running short on cash, and you take your TV to cash converters and you say, give me some cash for this. And they do. And then a couple of weeks later, your paycheck comes in and suddenly you've got money and you need your TV back. And so you go back to cash converters and you buy it back, you know, for twice the price. But that's what it is. That's what redeeming is, to buy something back. In the first century, one of the key ways that things were redeemed were slaves. Slaves were redeemed. So if you were a slave to someone, you could be bought out of slavery. And so that's what we are being bought back. We've been sold, if you like, into slavery, or rather we've sold ourselves off into slavery, and now we're being bought back. But what's the price? How much does it cost to buy us back? What's the going rate for our salvation? Well, he goes on, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement. Another great word, atonement, where our sins are atoned for. In other words, they are paid for. When you get a speeding fine, or when you get a parking fine or whatever it is, the way you atone for what you've done wrong is that you pay the fine, the appropriate fine. When we've done wrong, the wages of sin is death, Paul says. And so if we're going to be atoned for, it needs to be paid for by death. And that should be a death, our death. We've done the things wrong, but instead God presents Christ as a sacrifice to atone, to pay for the things that we have done through the shedding of his blood. So God doesn't pretend that our sin doesn't exist. He just shifts the payment for that sin onto Jesus. And so all of that anger, that righteous anger that God had for us, for our godlessness and wickedness that we heard about last week, that we kind of felt in despair about, that we're lost in that, under God's anger, all of that anger is now poured out onto Jesus. Like, I think I've used this illustration before, of being like a giant magnifying glass. Of all the anger that should have been for the whole world is actually just magnified down onto one person, onto Jesus. On the cross, the wrath of God that should have been our wrath, that we should have experienced, is being poured onto him. And so God is not sweeping our sin under the carpet. He is showing that he is righteous. That's what that kind of rather confusing verse from the second half of verse 25 means. He says, he did this to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his forbearance, or in his patience, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. So in other words, for God to be perfectly right and holy and just, to do the right thing, sin must be punished. Okay? So he shows that our sin is being punished. But he doesn't actually punish us. Instead, he punishes Jesus. So he's all at one time just, perfectly just and fair and right, but he's also the one who justifies, who actually sets us free from our sin, who pays for our sin. So he gives the verdict and the payment. He does both of those things. That's why he's just and the one who justifies. God shows his righteousness, his glory, his majesty, as he turns aside his anger from us to Jesus. There's a great word, a great theological word, that means God turning his anger. It's called propitiation. If you ever heard that word, use it over morning tea. It's a great word. Basically what that means is that God's anger, instead of being poured out into us, is poured onto Jesus, which is an incredible thing, don't you think? The first Anzacs, they gave their lives, the ultimate sacrifice, but in the end, their death didn't achieve what they set out for. They didn't capture that peninsula. They had to retreat. But when Jesus gives his life as a sacrifice for us, his death does achieve what he set out to do. His death is enough to pay for all sin, for all people, for all time. The sins before Jesus, that's what he means when he said, you know, the sins punished, sins from beforehand were left unpunished. The people before Jesus, they're saved through Jesus' death as well. Abraham, David, Daniel, all those people. Jesus' death pays for them as well, but also for us. His death is enough to pay for all people from all time. And it's not because God looks at us and goes, man, you guys are good. You guys are fantastic. He looks at us and he sees sinners. He sees objects of wrath, and yet he loves us anyway. That's what he's talking about when he means grace. So in verse 34, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, justified freely by his grace, through the redemption that came from Christ Jesus. All of this stuff that God does is not because of us, but despite of us. Despite the way we are. Despite how sinful we are. There's nothing that we can do to get us across that divide, and yet God comes to rescue us. It's a bit like, I don't know if you remember the movie Saving Private Ryan. Somebody was talking about the amount of people, amount of time and lives that have been spent on trying to rescue Matt Damon. But in all the different movies he's been in, but in Saving Private Ryan, the President of the United States sends a troop of Army Rangers to go and rescue this guy, Private Ryan, because his six brothers have all died. They've all been killed in the war, and it gets to the President's attention. He figured it would be a great PR thing to bring Private Ryan back, so that his mother doesn't lose all of her sons at once. And so he sends Tom Hanks, who's the leader of the platoon, to go and rescue this Private Ryan. They go through all these kind of difficulties and problems. They finally find him. And they say, we've come to rescue and take you back home. And he says, I don't want to go. I'm not leaving my unit. They're fighting. They're giving their lives. Why should I not stay and fight? And so Tom Hanks figures, well, our job is to make sure you get home. And so they vow to stay with him and protect him. And so they stay and they fight. I don't want to spoil the movie, but I'm going to. If you haven't seen it already, too late. You've had your chance. Basically, almost everybody dies, right? Except, of course, for Private Ryan. And as Tom Hanks character is dying on the ground, he whispers up to Private Ryan. He looks at him. He says, "Earn this. Earn this. Make sure your life makes this sacrifice worth what we've done." I heard of a movie review that was not released not long after by somebody who was an Army Ranger. And they were actually quite offended by their ending, because he pointed out that the motto of the Army Rangers is sua sponte, which means I choose this, or I chose this. He said an Army Ranger would never say earn this, because they would say this is my job. I'm just doing my job. I chose to do this, and I give my life willingly, because that's what I've chosen to do. That is what Jesus is like. Jesus will never say to us, earn this. I've died for you. But his grace is not say, I'll give you this, but you've got to give me something in return. That's not the way Jesus is for us. Jesus gives us this salvation. He gives us this new beginning, this new start. So this salvation that comes to us is despite us, it does something for us that we could never do for ourselves. And so how do we respond to it? Well, see if you can guess the way we should respond. There's a couple of verses. John, again, hides it. Oh, Paul, sorry, hides it in there. It's quite tricky. See if you can pick it up. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. In verse 25, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this, in verse 26, to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so to be just, and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus Christ. It's there in verse 26, it's there in verse 27, it's there in verse 28, it's there in verse 30, it's there in verse 31. Guess how it is that we grab hold of this? By faith. It is by faith. It's by putting our trust in Jesus. We cannot keep trying to get ourselves across the divide. We have to stop trying to jump in and swim across. The only way we can get across is through the bridge that God has built for us. Jesus is that bridge, and he just wants us to jump on the train that will take us across. That's what faith does. It recognizes that I can do nothing by myself. All I can do is accept it by faith. All I can do is to trust Jesus to do it for me. He has come to rescue me, like those Army Rangers. He has come to rescue me, and I have to just let them rescue me. I have to go with them and to accept that salvation that Jesus. That's how we respond to this. It's not by the things that we've done. And actually, because of that, Paul goes on to say, well, therefore, there's another consequence. As we grab hold of this by faith, we should never have the attitude of how good am I for doing this? Now, I think some people out there think the people in here are rather self-righteous. We look down our noses. That people feel like the people in the church look down our noses at others because we're so good and so clever. And I guess the reason they think that is because, well, sometimes we do, right? We do those things. We do treat people as if we're better than them. But Paul is saying there's no reason for that. Where then is boasting, he says, is excluded. You know, don't do it. Because of what law? The law that requires works? No. But because of the law that requires faith. In other words, if we were saved by what we did, you could be proud. Look what I did. I did all this stuff and I was saved. I got across the harbour. I got to God. I became righteous. But it's nothing to do with works. It's only by faith. And it's because of that faith, all we cannot boast. We should be doing the opposite. I don't know if some of you have heard of a guy by the name of Ricky Hoyt. Has anyone heard of Ricky Hoyt? Ricky Hoyt was a young lad,
he's older now, but he was a little boy who was completely and permanently disabled. There was no hope of a cure for him. He had cerebral palsy. He couldn't walk. He couldn't talk. He couldn't even eat without help. So you might be surprised to learn that Ricky actually completed the Hawaii Ironman Triathlon in 1989. You may think, wow, that must have been a miraculous cure. He must have just come back and worked really hard to get that. No, that's not the case at all. The Hawaii Ironman is one of the most grueling events on the whole planet. It's for those of you who don't know, it's run in serious heat, like in really almost unbearable heat. There's a 3.8-kilometre swim in open water. Then there's a 180-kilometre bike ride. And then just to top it off, as if that's not enough, there's a whole marathon, 42 kilometres that you have to run. And Ricky completed it. But of course, he didn't do it on his own. He couldn't do it on his own. He couldn't do anything. Instead, his father carried him. As he swam through the ocean, he pulled him behind him on a little dinghy. And so he swam with pulling his son along behind him. When he got onto the bike, he pedaled the 180 kilometres with Ricky strapped onto a cart in front of him. And then as he ran, he pushed him in a wheelchair until he got to the very end and carried him across the finish line. Incredible story. And as you can see, the pictures of it, it's incredible. They've actually done dozens of marathons and things around the world. They're incredible. His father's now died, but over the time, he did a lot of amazing things. Incredible. But as they're crossing the line, you can't imagine that Ricky is there in his father's arms going, look at me. Look how clever I am for getting my way through the Hawaii Ironman Triathlon. Look how smart I am, how powerful I am, but what a good athlete I am. Of course he wouldn't do that, because he didn't do anything. He just sat there. All he could do really is go, look at my dad. How incredible my dad is. He's rescued me. I mean, he's carried me all this way. He's shed blood and tears and sweat just to rescue me. Now, of course, that's a beautiful picture, I think, of our salvation. Because Jesus has not just sacrificed time and energy in carrying us, he's actually given his life for us. And so how could we boast? How could we, as we sit in his arms, being carried across the finish line, how could we go, well, look how good we are? Paul says, what place is there for boasting? It's totally excluded. Get that right out of your minds right now. All we can do, really, is respond with thanks, isn't it? To give the glory to Jesus, to point to Jesus and go, how amazing is my Saviour that even I can be saved? And so as we're sharing our faith, we're not sharing us, we're sharing Jesus. And we need to point people to Jesus. That's one of the reasons why Spring to Life, we want to proclaim the person of Jesus, because he's the one who's carried us, not us. We don't want people to see, oh, what a great church we are, what lovely people we are. We want people to see what a lovely Saviour we have, what a glorious Saviour we have. We want to point people to him. So where is boasting? There's no place for boasting. Instead, our only response can be thankfulness, surely. The final thing, really, that comes to us is in a very final verse. It says, do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law. What Paul's doing there, he's introducing a whole argument. It's going to happen over the next few weeks, as we'll see. But this whole idea of, you know, wasn't Jesus a Jew, and wasn't Abraham a Jew, and weren't the promises for the Jews, and how do the Gentiles fit in? And now, you know, God gave the law to Moses, and so that's for the Jews, and is it for the Gentiles? And so he's going to go through this whole argument we're going to be talking about in the next couple of weeks. But in the end, what I think Paul is saying here is this, because we're saved by faith, doesn't mean that it doesn't matter what we do. We're rescued by faith. All I do is got to get in the train, it's going to carry me across the bridge. Steve just said that. And so I don't need to do anything. Does it mean I really don't have to do anything? Is that what faith means? You just sit there and put your feet up? Well, as we're going to see, he says, no, that's not the case. True faith is not like that. True faith upholds the law. It lives out the holiness of God. I mean, after all, it was our rejection of God and the law and all of that, living God's way, that got us in our trouble in the first place. So how can we, if God, Jesus rescued from that, how can we then just dive straight back in? Of course we can't. And so, as we're going to see in the coming weeks, true faith shows itself in the things that we do. As we saw in that passage that Graham referenced in Ephesians 2, we're saved by grace through faith, exactly the same message as here, but we're saved for the works that God has provided for us to do. We are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do the works that he's prepared for us. And so, yes, it will have implications for our lives, being a Christian, but those things are not the things that save us. It is our faith, our trust in Jesus that gets us across the line. Last week's passage was a really heavy one. A bit depressing, really, wasn't it? But we saw actually that it was actually quite good news because it actually was telling us as it really is. It was giving us a true diagnosis of our problem. It was showing us the predicament we got ourselves into. And we need to know that. We need to know where we are. But the good news about the gospel is it doesn't stop there. Because if that's good news, then this is stupendous news. This is awesome news. Because we don't just know the problem, now we know the solution. Jesus is the solution. Faith in Jesus, in his death, in what he has done. The fact that he's come to give himself as a sacrifice, to pay the penalty for what we had done. That he has taken all God's anger on himself. And so he calls us now to respond with faith, with thanks, and with obedience. And so let's, as we remember this gospel, it's really important for us to keep remembering this gospel, to keep, we never actually kind of outgrow the gospel. We always need to hear this. We always need to be reminded of what is it that binds us. What is this that brings us to God? It's not about ourselves. It's always about him. Let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we confess to you that sometimes, well, we confess to you as we saw last week that all of us are sinful. All of us have fallen short. All of us have separated ourselves from you, and there's nothing we could do. We confess that sometimes we try to make you love us by the things that we do. Sorry, Lord, for the times when we've felt pride at being a Christian, about being holy. Lord, you've made us clean, but we haven't done anything. So we want to say thank you for that. We want to thank you so much for Jesus. It's astounding to us that he would come and sacrifice himself when he didn't have to do that. We deserve the exact opposite of that. And so, Lord, we thank you for giving us that hope, that salvation, that new beginning. Thank you for making us righteous. And so now, Lord, we pray that you'd help us to live as people who are righteous. Help us to always be blown away by the wonder of you carrying us across that line. Help us always to be excited to share, and as we think about sharing with our friends, Lord, just pray that it must just bubble out of us what you've done, but also you might bubble out of us in the way that we live. Help us to be the kind of people you want us to be. Show us how you want us to be, Lord, and help us to be obedient, we pray. Amen.
Right, well, thank you, Steve, for that. That was really challenging. And as we reflect on it, we're going to be singing a song that ties in very much with what Steve concluded. I will trust my Saviour Jesus. Please stand.
Jesus,
trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart be ever yours. Jesus, only Jesus, help me trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart. Jesus, only Jesus, help me trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart be ever yours. Jesus, only Jesus, help me trust you more and more. Jesus, only Jesus, may my heart be ever yours.
We come now to our prayer time, so would you like to just join me in prayer? Lord, this is the day that you have made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it for all that you have given us. This morning we lay our requests before you and wait in expectation. Lord, as we look upon our world, we see so much suffering, fighting, cruelty. But thank you, Lord, that we know that you are in control, even when we only see turmoil. Lord, we pray again for the Ukraine, that you will bring that terrible conflict to an end, for a peaceful resolution to the situation in Sudan and other conflicts around the world. And we know, Lord, that it is the poor and needy who suffer most in these wars. Please have compassion on them. And also, Lord, we pray for those countries where your people are persecuted. Please stand with them, Lord, strengthen them as they seek to witness for you in the most extreme circumstances. And we know as your people that we must always stand on your word, not deviate from what is the truth in the Bible. Help us to never compromise on your word. So we pray for the Anglican Church in England, for some who have strayed from your word, that they might repent. Please strengthen those Anglican ministers who are not prepared to compromise on your word, and help and give them wisdom about how they should now proceed. We also pray for Charles after his coronation yesterday. Lord, we ask that he serves his people with strength and compassion, and that he himself will be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Lord, in our own country, we pray for the suffering, for those who are poor, needy, homeless, refugees, those who suffer violence in any way. And we thank and praise you that there are organizations who help these people. And particularly today, we thank you for Anglicare with its many avenues of help and support for the needy. Thank you for the winter food drive that is coming up at the end of the month, and pray that we and our community will be generous at this coldest time of the year. And also, Lord, we ask that our governments, both federal and state, will govern for the good of all and with compassion for the needy. So this morning, as our mission focus, we pray for the work of the Bush Church Aid Society. Thank you, Lord, for the BCA Nomads. Thank you for the many people who on their travels take the time to help in many ways and to encourage groups of your people in remote areas. May you increase the number of BCA Nomads. And we also thank you for the Cal family as they live and witness for you in Byrie and at the university. This morning, they were all due to land in Sydney, and so we ask for them a time of rest and refreshment. Happy reunions with their families before they start their deputation work. And we ask, Lord, that they will communicate clearly as they report to their linked parishes, and that they will be encouraged by those visitors. And now in our own parish, we continue to pray for Steve and Lorna, John and Fiona. We thank you for each of them, for their leadership, caring, encouragement, and challenging us to live each day for you. Please sustain them daily in this role to which you have called them. And as we've been reminded, this is now Meal May, and we ask you, Lord, to help us to make contact and to get to know our neighbours, whom you have placed near us. Help us to be bold in asking them to visit us for a meal or coffee or whatever. May there be gospel opportunities as we get to know them better. And we also commend to you this afternoon's meeting about our outreach in September. Please inspire those who are organizing the events so people in our community may really want to attend them. And Lord, we know that you are close to the brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit. We ask, Lord, for those who are known to us and dear to us, who are suffering at this time. And we now just take a moment in the quietness of our hearts to bring them before you. And we thank you and praise you, Lord, that Kim Shaw is out of hospital and for his successful knee operation. We ask for his ongoing healing and for Deb as she cares for him. So, Lord, as we think about the week that is ahead of us as we leave here and as we go about our usual tasks, help us, Lord, to pursue righteousness, godliness, endurance, and gentleness, that we may continue to fight the good fight of faith. And we ask this all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Amen. Would you like to now join in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Just a couple of things of announcement this week. Barbara's just spoiled them all, but that's okay, as you pray for them. Thank you. just things that are coming up this week. First one is this afternoon at 2 o'clock here in the hall. I want to invite whoever's interested to come and to talk. We're starting to talk about Spring to Life. We've got a number of different activities already sorted out or on the way of being organised. So young families have got another picnic style, a fair actually it's called, isn't it? I've got a fair happening, so that'd be fantastic. The seniors are having a seniors expo, and we've got some other things that we're interested in doing, but this afternoon we want to start the preparations for those different events. So if you're free at 2 o'clock this afternoon and would like to have some kind of input into what happens for the people that you're wanting to invite to come and hear the gospel, then please come along. What we're doing is we'll be meeting in here. We think a little about last year, and then we're going to split up into three different groups. We're going to have one group that is going to talk about the men's outreach. We're going to have another group that's going to talk about the women's outreach, and another group that's going to be talking about the seniors' outreach. And so please come along. If you're interested in any one of those things, if you've got friends that you know who don't know Jesus yet and you'd like to invite them to something and you'd like to have an input to say what that might be and also to help organise it, then that would be great. So please come along. Hope you're able to come and join us 2 o'clock this afternoon. Then also, Barbara also reminded us in our prayer time, which is great, about the fact that we're now in May. And so during May as a church, we haven't got too many other activities on. But one of the things we're encouraging people to do is to invite people to a meal, maybe a lunch or an afternoon tea or a dinner at their place. And I won't ask you to put your hands up. Maybe next week I might ask to see who's either invited someone or is planning to invite someone. I hope you are. We're planning to invite our next door neighbours to come over for dinner. I hope that you might consider doing something similar. Maybe a neighbour, it may be a family member, maybe a friend that you want to build a relationship with. That hopefully in the context of that relationship you might be able to have a chance to share your faith with them. There's no pressure on that meeting. You don't have to kind of go through the four spiritual laws or anything like that with them. You just got to get to know them as people. So that's during May. So I hope you're thinking and praying about who you might be inviting. And with your Bible study group, I hope you're praying for each other as you think about doing that. So those who are leaders of Bible study groups or coordinating Bible studies, you might want to encourage the members of your group, okay, to share who it is that they're going to be inviting and spend some time praying for each other in that. So that would be really good. So that's that. And is there something else? There must be something else. Forgotten. Oh, yes, there is. Ben, do you want to come and do this?
Thanks, Steve. I just wanted to share with you, so some of you may be aware, we've spoken a little bit about a coffee ministry, and the church has stepped out in faith and bought a coffee machine and a grinder, and that's something that we've got available to use at different mission events and at different ministries. So we'll kick that off next Sunday for Mother's Day, so please come along and enjoy a coffee. But if that's something that you are keen to learn and to engage in and to use, and I know there's so many different ministries that we have in the church, and we'd love to be able to use that, please let us know and we can train you up in the use of the machine. And we'd also love to get rosters and different things like that. But yeah, thank you to all those people that have put it on their heart to support that and to donate. So that was bought through full donations from people at the church. But yeah, if you can let me know if you're keen to get trained up and get involved, that'd be great.
Thank you. Yeah, some people have expressed concern about, you know, do we need a coffee machine, that kind of thing. And we, as a parish council, we've been thinking and praying about this for the last couple of months, and we've come to the decision that we can see a real value in this ministry, not just because wouldn't it be nice for us to have nice coffee, but as a way, as Ben described it, as a ministry tool for us to use. And so this, we're planning to have this coffee machine, we'll be using it on Sunday mornings, but also for things like junior jivers and all the different activities. So when we have Spring to Life, we'll be using it then, and other activities. And if you're running an activity in the church and would like, so Sip and Stitch, I think, is here on Tuesday. If you wanted to learn how to use it for that, then that's great as a way of helping people to feel more at home. In the same way that we don't just give people kind of arrowroot biscuits for morning tea, we like to make people feel that we've got something really nice to give them. Same kind of idea with the coffee, is that we want to make them feel this is something in our society that people value. And so it's really, we're excited about that. We think it's going to be a really wonderful thing. For those who are on morning tea, however, I don't want you to be scared about this, because I think some people have been concerned, oh, now I've got to learn how to make coffee. You know, it's hard enough to make morning tea. This is not something that's going to be dumped on the morning tea people to do. Okay, so if you're on the morning tea roster, don't feel like, oh no, I've now got to learn how to make the coffee. This is something that will be an extra on top of that. Okay, so there, as Ben's talking about, we're wanting to build a ministry team who see this as a part of the way of serving others. And so for people who are doing morning tea will stay exactly as it is. It's just that this will become an option as well if people want to have proper coffee made as well. I mean, you know, coffee's disgusting, so why would you drink it anyway? But I hear that people like it from the community. So anyway, so that's kind of the rationale behind it. So I want to say thanks to Ben for and Eileen for kind of getting this moving, but also as Parish Council, we're really excited about it, and as a staff to see how this can be used for ministry. So thank you for those who donated.
Right, well, our service isn't exactly a marathon, but we have reached the last leg. our conclusion song. But yeah, look, it's so good to meet together and to have fellowship. And I'd just like to read from Ephesians 3:20. Paul writes, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever." And everyone says, Amen.
Is our hope in life and death, Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence, that our souls to him belong? What holds our days within his hand? What comes apart from his command? And what will keep is good, God is good. There is his grace and goodness found in our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith with his eyes, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us high to the shore. Eternal.